Okay, let us start our next session on the gift of different types of tongues. And today when we look at the gift of different types of tongues, we're going to first eliminate some confusion before we explain what this gift of different kinds of tongues is. So if you look at, if you open 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verse 2, and 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verse 2, if somebody can read it, it will be good. 1 Corinthians 14 verse 2, and then another person, if he can take and open 1 Corinthians 14 verse 22, one person, 1 Corinthians 14:2, and another person, 1 Corinthians 14:22. Go ahead and read it. Or the same person can read both.
Okay, thank you. For one who speaks in tongues does not speak to men but to God. For no one understands, but in his spirit he speaks mysterious. And verse 22.
Yes.
So then tongues are for a sign, not to those who believe, but to unbelievers. But prophecy is for a sign, not to unbelievers, but to those who believe.
Okay. So now let's unpack what these two verses mean. Now in verse 2 of 1 Corinthians 14, it says tongues, when a person speaks in tongues, he does not speak to men. He speaks only to God, and he speaks mysteries to God. No one understands, neither does he understand. So verse 2 says, tongues is a language that only God understands. No one understands, he doesn't understand, the devil doesn't understand. Only God, the Holy Spirit, understands this language. It's a language that the Holy Spirit understands, and I even don't understand. The devil also doesn't understand. And it is a person who prays in tongues to the Holy Spirit. He is praying in tongues and he's uttering mysteries, meaning sacred secrets or sacred answers that the Holy Spirit is revealing in him and through him. Now, verse 22 says, tongues are a sign not for believers but for unbelievers. Now, if we really are good students of the Bible, we'll see a contradiction there. Here in verse 2 it says, tongues is a language only God understands. And then over here, verse 22, it says, tongues is a language, it is not for believers, it is only for unbelievers. So why is a believer praying in tongues? Why is an unbeliever only this language? So it's talking about two different tongues. It's talking about two different tongues. In verse 2, it's talking about the language called praying in tongues, and verse 22 says speaking in tongues. So what is the difference between praying in tongues and speaking in tongues? Praying in tongues is you pray to God directly. You do not pray. I do not pray to Spurgeon. I do not pray to Sister Jennifer. Neither does Brother Uday pray to me. We talk to each other. So tongues are a sign for unbelievers, means that is speaking in tongues. Then when a man prays in tongues, he prays only to God, not to men. That means that's a praying in tongues. So first we have to make a big difference between praying in tongues and speaking in tongues. Praying in tongues is speaking to God. And speaking in tongues is speaking to human beings or to myself. Now, the word unbelievers, if you look at the Greek word, the word over there in the Greek is the word I-D-O-T-E-S. I-D-O-T-E-S. Now, what is I-D-O-T-E-S? If you listen to the word very carefully, I-D-O-T-E-S, it's from there we get the English word idiot. So, what does an idiot mean? A person who does not have proper understanding, a person who's foolish regarding a certain matter, a person who's ignorant regarding certain matter, he's an idiot. So over here it says tongues are a sign for unbelievers or tongues are a sign for idiots. It means tongues are a sign for those who are ignorant. Tongues are a sign for those who have not found Jesus Christ. Tongues are a sign for those believers that are foolish. So when we say unbelievers over there, it means Christians and non-Christians. It means those who are idiots, those who are foolish, those who are ignorant, those who are stupid, those who don't know, you know, the things of God. And if you read further down in 1 Corinthians 14, when you speak words of prophecy and an unbeliever comes into your congregation or your meeting and they hear prophecy, they'll say, oh, men are speaking to one another. It's a language of men. But when tongues and interpretation of tongues is expressed in the meeting, the secrets of their heart is laid bare and they will fall down and they will say, really, God is in this place. That's what 1 Corinthians 14 says. If you read the whole context, you will be benefited. So as homework from my side, please read 1 Corinthians 12 full, 1 Corinthians 13 full, a love chapter, and then 1 Corinthians 14 full, because it's a divine sandwich. I call it the divine sandwich. Top part of the bread is the gifts, and the bottom part of the bread is the how to operate in the gifts. And the middle part of the bread is where the meat is, the most exciting thing is. And that is the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and how to exercise them. So now, let's come back to, tongues, different kinds of tongues. Over here, we are talking about, one is the language of our spirit. When we pray, our spirit prays, our mind prays with our natural human language, but our tongues pray with a supernatural language. And when we speak in tongues in a public service, or in the street, or on the bus, or when we are going to an unreached people group, sometimes we are speaking in tongues, and the language they understand is their own mother tongue. We have not learned that language, but they understand when we are speaking in tongues, they understand it as German or Welsh or Iranian or Persian or Farsi or many different languages. But one thing I want to share over here is when we are baptized in the Holy Spirit, say there is a water baptism, that is done by man, like John the Baptist. Men like John the Baptist give us water baptism, which is a baptism to repentance. But Jesus said in Matthew 2:11, John the Baptist says about Jesus, he shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Holy Spirit, why not only Holy Spirit? Why fire? Because in the day of Pentecost, chapter 2, tongues of fire came to rest on them and they spoke in tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. Not an utterance they learned from their childhood. And then if you see in the book of James, it says our tongue is a fire. So is our tongue made out of flesh or fire? A human beings touch the tongue and they say it's flesh. But book of James says our tongue is a fire. So the first thing the Holy Spirit does is when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, you start praying in tongues. That is not speaking in tongues. When you are baptized in the Holy Spirit, the first thing that comes out of your mouth as you go into the Holy Spirit fire which Jesus baptized you with, when Jesus baptizes people with the Holy Spirit, they will speak in tongues. And that will be not a speech for human beings. It will be a speech between God and man. Between me and my Creator. Between me and my Heavenly Father. Between me and Jesus. Between me and the Holy Spirit. And sometimes when I'm praying in tongues, I'm speaking between me and angels also. So when we pray in tongues, it is a language I don't understand. The devil doesn't understand. But the Heavenly Father understands, Jesus understands, the Holy Spirit understands, and the angels understand. And so when we are praying in tongues, sometimes we are praying and we do not know what we are praying, but we are praying the answer. But we are praying the answer. Let me give you an example, a very beautiful example. One lady, she was walking in the sabji market. She was buying vegetables. And then she felt a strong urge from the Holy Spirit. Pray in tongues now, in a very soft voice without disturbing the vegetable sellers. Pray softly in tongues right now, right now, right now. And so she felt like, okay, the Holy Spirit is really like a commander. I must obey him. So she started praying in tongues as she was buying vegetables. So she took about 1 hour before she came back home. And she was wondering why the Holy Spirit challenged her to pray in tongues. But as soon as she came into the house, she looked, front door was broken. She ran inside. Her whole house was upside down. Tables, chairs, papers were here, there, everywhere. She looked for all the gold in her safe. It was there. She looked for all the money in her wallet. It was there. She looked for all the valuables in the house. It was there. But the house was like, it looked like somebody had rummaged across the whole house and made it so untidy and left. So she didn't understand what happened. So she sat down. She said, okay, I prayed in tongues, but now can you please give me the interpretation of tongues? So then she prayed. As she prayed, the Holy Spirit spoke to her and said, when I told you to start praying in tongues in the sabji mandi, the sabji market, the vegetable market, at that same time, a thief was entering your house to rob your house. And the moment you started praying in tongues, instantly, as soon as the thieves entered, as soon as they entered the house, they became temporarily blind. They could not rob anything. They could not find where they were. And so eventually, after falling over tables and chairs and trying to, with their hands, try to feel some valuables and then just emptying everything to try and search for something, they gave up and they ran out of the house. But this is what the Holy Spirit interpreted to her, what had happened. So when we pray in tongues, the language, we don't understand sometimes what we are praying, why we are praying. But if you keep on praying in tongues, God is doing revival in your heart. God is doing revival in your house, in your church. God is doing a lot of miracles, signs and wonders in your area, in your country, in the world. And the Holy Spirit is using your tongue to pray the answer, using your tongue to pray the deliverance, using your tongue to pray the healing on people. So now when we pray in tongues, sometimes we think, oh, if I don't understand, what is the use? But actually, when we pray in tongues, sometimes it's better for us not to understand what God is doing so that He gets all the glory. When we get to heaven, only we'll understand fully. How many times we prayed in tongues, we didn't understand. But when we started praying in tongues, how God started doing miracle in our neighbor's life, in Christians' lives, in non-Christians' lives. Many believers, many non-Christians came to know the Lord through praying in tongues and stuff like that. So when we pray in tongues, it is a language. It is a relationship starter. So the praying in tongues is the number one doorway to all the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. Speaking in tongues is also one gift. Interpretation of tongues is also one gift. But this praying in tongues does not come under the 9 gifts. It comes under your prayer language, your communication language with the Holy Spirit. Now say, sometimes when a Tamilian is speaking in front of me, I understand everything they say because I grew up in Chennai. But sometimes a person from Andhra Pradesh speaking Telugu or Kerala is speaking Malayalam, I don't understand what they're saying. But when we pray in tongues, the Holy Spirit understands what we are saying. As we are speaking, the Holy Spirit is understanding. The Holy Spirit is using that prayer to bring miracles, signs and wonders in our lives and activate all the other 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. So now let me give you a couple of examples from my life. There's so many examples. I need to be careful with the time. Okay, we have some time. So one of the things of me praying in tongues is that, you know, when I got saved, the first time that I got saved, you know, after a couple of years, one person from Andhra came to our church in Calcutta and he was talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I said, I want to receive this gift. So I went forward and I received the gift of praying in tongues. And ever since then, I started praying in tongues a lot. I said, Lord, as I'm praying in tongues, you use me. So one day what happened is I went to a church and they had an all-night prayer meeting. In that all-night prayer meeting, everybody was, sitting down and everybody was praying. And we started at 9 p.m. in the night. And this went on till about 5 a.m. in the morning. So as I was in that meeting, I was praying and I was talking and spending fellowship time with the believers and praying. And during one of the sessions, out of my mouth, the pastor was speaking from the pulpit and he was speaking through the mic. But it was a worship prayer time. And I started speaking in tongues so loudly, like as if I, you know, when we scream and shout and we tell a mad dog to run away, how we scream at a mad dog, you know, that kind of language was coming out of my mouth. And I was thinking to myself, as it was coming out of my mouth, my language was so loud that not even the mic could stop me from how loud my voice was. And I was shocked. My voice was like a lion, like a tiger. It was screaming at the top of his lungs with anger. And then the pastor was trying to stop me with the mic, but nobody could hear him. He could not hear himself also, because I was screaming that loudly in tongues. And then after I screamed loudly in tongues, then I stopped. And the moment I stopped, then everybody became quiet. Because now when we speak in tongues, what happens is you have to speak in tongues, and then the second next gift after that is interpretation of tongues. So I was thinking, okay, Lord, now what are you doing? Like, please interpret, because many people are going to be shocked if there's no interpretation of tongues. That means this is a tongues that did not come from God. We have actually made it up in our mind. So as I was praying in tongue, as I was praying quietly, I said, Lord, give the interpretation. God gave me one word. So how does the interpretation of tongues come? The interpretation of tongues come by a simple word, one word from God. And so one word from God is how you do the interpretation of tongues. So I was thinking to myself, okay, Lord, you are going to do this through me. That one word that he gave me was, the devil has tried to make this church into a den of thieves. So I got that word, and in obedience to the Lord, I opened my mouth and I started saying, the devil has tried to make this church into a den of thieves. And the words that came after that, it just came out of my spirit. I didn't have anything after that. And the words that came out of my spirit after that is, the devil has tried to make this church into a den of thieves, but today I, the Lord, am taking it back and am making this my house of prayer again. And I said those words and I sat down. Everybody was quiet. Then the whole night prayer meeting continued. Then 5 a.m. in the morning, as I was leaving the church, the pastor, who's a lady pastor, she shook my hand and she smiled. And she said, "Brian, thank you for that message in tongues and the interpretation of tongues. We were really blessed by what you shared." So I went back home and I was just praying and I was like wondering why God is saying that this church, some people have tried to make it a den of thieves and God is taking it back and making it again a house of prayer. Why is God saying that? So with the church, also they had a ministry, a hospital ministry. They have a church, they have a hospital attached to the church, which is part of the ministry of the church. And then next week, I saw in the front page of the Calcutta newspapers, it was written, 22 accountants from the hospital have been stealing the Provident Fund money of God's servants and all those who are employed in the hospital and in the church. 22 accountants were exposed. They were stealing the Provident Fund money of the people. And then I realized, okay, tongues and interpretation of tongues happen like this. It is very, very long time ago when I was just a new Christian. I just received the gift of praying in tongues. I had just received the gift of, and then the gift of interpretation of tongues was revealed to me that day. I was so happy. I said, "God, that means interpretation of tongues sometimes will not happen in a church service, but it'll happen and the church will come to know that this is exactly how God is interpreting the tongues." So then after that, I went and I started serving the Lord. I was working in a bank at that time, ANZ Grinlay's Bank, and I was going church to church, house to house, you know, prayer meeting to prayer meeting, Bible study to Bible study, going to slum streets, you know, dance bars, cabin restaurants, sharing the gospel with different groups from different churches and organizations. And then one day I met one person. He was a communist leader who then had accepted Jesus Christ as his savior. And he had his own house and he converted his house into a house of prayer. He said, "This is a house of prayer. And then I will get people to come here from different churches. They will pray." And he was a very big communist leader, but he retired. And he said, "From now onwards, I want to dedicate my life to pray for the people of God, to pray for revival, to pray for people to be saved." So what happened was that he got to know about me and my group, that we go and we pray for miracles, signs and wonders all over Calcutta. So then he invited me, "Come, bring your group to pray." So I used to take my group there. We used to pray all night. We used to pray sometimes all day. There used to be seminars and conferences and Bible studies, prayer meetings and stuff like that. And he became very close to me. He says, "See, my son is also a Bible teacher, but he's in Australia. I have no son over here. And there's another boy I've adopted. He's a very good evangelist. He goes to the streets, you know, and he brings many people to the Lord. But I don't have anybody who teaches the word of God like you. So I have a land on my right side of my building. It's a big plot of land. I want to give it to you as a gift. Why don't you start your church there? We'll also become members of your church. And then we can, you know, use that for the glory of God. Since your vision and my vision matches, let's do together." So out of my mouth, I wanted to say, "Oh, thank you for giving me this property." But out of my mouth did not come that. The Holy Spirit did not allow me to say thank you. The Holy Spirit made me say, "I will pray." And when I said, "I will pray," he understood that I wanted to pray on the land. So he said, "Okay, when will you come? Will you come tomorrow to pray for the land?" Then I understood that this person, his name is Hazra, he said to me, "Okay, come and pray over there." I thought he understood that. So I said, "Okay, I'll come tomorrow and pray." So Monday morning, I arrived at 10 o'clock and I went and I sat there was a small, like bamboo shed with bamboos. And I went and sat over there at 10 o'clock. And I opened my mouth to pray and only tongues came out. And I was praying in tongues, praying in tongues, praying in tongues, praying in tongues. And then I said to myself, Are, what is this? I'm not able to pray in my other language, only in tongues. 1 hour finished, 2 hours finished, 3 hours finished, 4 hours finished. Then 4 o'clock came. I'm still praying in tongues. Then I said, I'm tired. I need to go home now and have some food. So I went, they offered me food and snacks and tea. I didn't take. So I went into the house, and then Mr. Hazra said to me, Are, tell me, what did God tell you? I said, He told me nothing. All He allowed me to do was not even pray in my English language. He told me to pray in tongues. And I prayed in tongues from 10 o'clock in the morning to 4 o'clock. So He said, now what you will do? I said, I'll come back tomorrow and pray. Because the job is not done. He'll give me the interpretation of tongues, maybe tomorrow. So I went next day, Tuesday. Started praying in tongues, 10 o'clock. Completed 4 o'clock. No other language. Same thing happened Tuesday, same thing happened Wednesday, same thing happened Thursday, same thing happened Friday also. So at Friday at 4 o'clock, Mr. Hazra asked me, so what did God tell you? You know, I told him, I said, Hazra sir, I'm very sorry to tell you, I am not able to pray in English in that property. And every time I'm praying in tongues, I'm not getting any interpretation of tongues. So I'm going to go home. Please forgive me. But I'm going to go home. If God tells me to come back and pray over there, I'll pray, but I cannot take that property from you. I'm just going to continue to pray for you. So he said, okay, come back whenever you want to come. Bring your groups again and pray. Let's see what the Lord will do. So I went back, and then I got busy in the ministry because I used to travel all over India teaching the word of God, signs, wonders, miracles all over India. Then after about 2 months, I came back to Calcutta. And when I came, this Mr. Hazra, he knew one of my doctor friends. So he told the doctor friend, the moment Brian comes to Calcutta, tell him to call me. So as soon as I arrived, my doctor friend said, he's telling you to call him. So I quickly called him. Now when I called him, he was so happy to hear my voice. He said, Brian, you have to come here. A lot of miracles have taken place over here. So when I went after 2 months, went to his house. He said, he came, he showed me. On that property, there is a beautiful church now. Fully built in 2 months' time. And the house, and there's a toilet, there's a baptism tank. There is a, lovely chairs, tables. I said, what happened over here? So then Hazra, he gave me, he says, when you prayed in tongues, the interpretation came like this. Every day my door started knocking from the next day that you left. One person knocked the door and said, is there a person called Hazra here? So he said, yes, I'm Hazra. So well, when I was praying in the night, in my dream, then a voice said to me, go to Hazra and he will tell you the way to eternal life. What is eternal life? So then Hazra was able to lead him to the Lord. Another person was not very well. He had some sickness. While he was praying, while he was sleeping in the night, he was not a Christian. The dream came, go to Hazra and he will pray for you, you will be healed. So he went knocking on Hazra's door. Hazra prayed for him. He got healed. Like that, within a month or half a month, there were more than 60 people like that. And one person came and told him, you know, when I was sleeping last night, he told me, from now onwards, you are going to go to another church. This is the name of the pastor. His name is Pastor Hazra. And you go and you join his church. Because his brother, he was looking for churches. He couldn't find a proper church home for himself. So when he went and told Pastor Hazra, you are my pastor from today onwards. In a dream, Jesus told me, you're going to be my pastor. So Hazra said, I'm not a pastor, yaar. So he said, but God said you're a pastor. So you better be a pastor and you better be my pastor. And then they built a water baptism tank. They built a church and then dedication service. Pastor, the Pastor Hazra called me to his church and he says, now I would like this church to be dedicated to the Lord by Brian, because this is how he was praying in tongues and the interpretation of tongues came. And the interpretation of tongues was not word interpretation, but actual miracle interpretation, actual signs and wonders interpretation, actual answer to the prayers of all these people that are sitting here. They are all come to know Jesus and they have all come to become part of this church family because Brian prayed in tongues from 10 o'clock in the morning till 4 o'clock from Monday to Friday. And so he said, please keep on coming regularly and teaching the word of God over here. But now God has told me that I am supposed to be the pastor of this congregation. And so wonderfully well, you know, God planted a church by praying and speaking in tongues, and he brought church members by interpretation of tongues. So when we look at the language of tongues and interpretation of tongues, see, I'm teaching this, both these gifts together. I'm not teaching it separately because these two gifts are like twins, tongues and interpretation of tongues. If there is no tongues, there cannot be interpretation of tongues. So these are companion gifts. This is like twins. It's like two gifts that are stuck together as one, just like husband and wife, just like sun and moon. It's like two gifts that operate all the time together. Okay. So now tongues and interpretation of tongues, the way I would like to explain it, you know, a little bit further, is that when you pray in tongues, you don't know what you're praying. And when you go in a public meeting and you speak in tongues and the Holy Spirit says, stand up and speak, be foolish enough for Christ. Don't be foolish and wise in the eyes of the world and not speak in tongues. So God will tell you to speak in tongues in the midst of the people. Stand up and speak. God will give you the interpretation of tongues. Stand up and interpret. But whether it's tongues or interpretation of tongues, remember, it is never about condemnation or judgmental attitudes, okay? So when we speak in tongues, when we pray in tongues, when we interpret tongues, the language, whatever is spoken, should always be edification and comfort. It should bring comfort. It should build the body of Christ up. It should recharge their batteries. It should encourage them. It should comfort them. So anytime some person speaking in tongues, and then interpretation is, you are going to hell, you are all bad, you are all repent, you are wicked. That's not from God. That is from that person's flesh. The tongues is something else that he's praying, but he's interpreting something else from his flesh. The flesh will always condemn. The flesh will always judge people. The flesh will always criticize. But tongues is not, tongues and interpretation is not given to criticize, to complain, to condemn and to judge people. Tongues and interpretation of tongues is always given to build up the body of Christ, to recharge their batteries, bring revival, as well as to comfort them and encourage them. So every time tongues and interpretation of tongues comes, it is for the purpose of encouraging the body of Christ, building up the body of Christ, comforting the body of Christ, and bringing revival in the body of Christ. I'll give you one more example of this amazing message. One of my friends, he has a church in Delhi. And one day, you know, there was a German man. He had killed somebody somewhere in Delhi. And he was running for his life from the police. And this German man suddenly saw that there was a church. Praise and worship was going on. So he thought, oh, good, I'll go hide inside the church among the people. The police will not be able to catch me. So he went and hid among the crowd. And then as he hid in the crowd, one lady stood up and started speaking in tongues. And she spoke for about 15 minutes. And after 15 minutes, this German man, he started crying and he ran to the altar and he knelt down and he says, I want to accept Jesus Christ. Please, quickly, quickly, lead me to the Lord. And so the pastor led him to the Lord and he said, why did you come to know the Lord like this? He says, that lady, she's speaking in German. So the pastor said, no, she's not speaking in German. She does not know German. She's a person from Delhi. She's never been to Germany. She never touched a German book. So then he said, how she knows German? And then the pastor realized, then he said, okay, this is the gift of different kinds of tongues. So this different kind of tongue now is German. She's speaking in German. What did she say? And she said, when she was praying in tongues, she mentioned me by my name. And she said, God is telling me right now that if you go ahead and surrender. Okay, so then this German lady, this lady who did not speak any German at all, she was speaking in perfect German. And as she was speaking in German, she was saying this man's name. She was saying where he's from. God was saying, my son, if you repent and you give your life to Christ, I'll take you to jail. You surrender to the police, I'll take you to jail and I will use you in the jail for my glory. And don't worry, I will protect you as you go as jail. But surrender yourself to the police. You're my son, I will take care of you. And this German man then surrendered his life to Jesus. And he surrendered himself to the police. And he went to jail and God used him mightily in the jail ministry over there. So sometimes tongues and interpretation of tongues, some people will understand that language. Yeah. So let me give one more example. There is a pastor from Africa. His name is Pastor Ehambi Kufil Losongo. And God used him very mightily in the signs and wonders in Africa. And so some preachers from America invited him to come and speak in their church. And so as soon as he went to the church, you know, he went and he was waiting to go up and to preach the message. When he heard one of the elders on his left, he was praying in tongues with a loud voice. And he was praying in the African language of this pastor. He did not know. He was just praying in tongues. So as he was praying in tongues in the worship service, you know, our friend pastor, Lufil Kozongo, he understood his language as an African language. And so then what he did was, he went up in the pulpit when his time was to preach. He called the elder up and he called the pastor up and then he said to the pastor, what I'm going to say now may shock you, but it is good for your congregation. I can see that many people in the congregation, evil spirits have begun to work in their life, and it's because of sin in your church. So pastor said, what does that mean? What do you mean by that? So he turned to the elder who was praying in tongues and he said to him, elder, you were praying in tongues, but you did not know that that was my mother tongue you were praying in, African language. And in the African language, you were repenting before God and you were telling God, forgive me, God, for having committed sexual sins with the daughter of the pastor. I'm living in sexual sin with her secretly. Nobody knows, but God, you know. So you must forgive me. I repent. And when that message was given to the church, everybody was shocked. And the elder fell down on his knees and repented before the Lord. The daughter was not in the church, but the pastor believed the message of God. Later on, confronted the daughter also. And there was great revival in the church, great repentance in the church. The demonic spirits that were coming through the open door of sexual sin was stopped. And the church again began to serve the Lord with full revival, full power. You know, sometimes when we are praying in tongues, we don't even know we are repenting. Sometimes we don't even know we are repenting for somebody else's sin or our sin. You know, an interpretation of tongues sometimes can come and sometimes interpretation won't come to us, but we will be praying the answer. That itself is interpretation. So what is interpreting? Something happens, something miracle happens in a person's life. For me personally, when last 30 plus years I've been praying in tongues, I can tell you the secret of my marriage, the secret of my ministry, the secret of all the finances that I'm able to raise for our ministry, the miracle signs and wonders that happen in my ministry. Everything that happens in my ministry is because from morning till afternoon to evening, whenever I get a chance, whether it's in the toilet or on the bus or walking on the street or walking on the terrace or lying down, you know, and sleeping before the Lord and praying, I pray in tongues non-stop. More than anything in my spiritual life, more than anything, the number one thing I do from morning till night, whenever I get an opportunity, whenever I get a chance, is to pray in tongues. Because the praying in tongues is the doorway to the miracle of all miracles. When we pray in tongues, the doorway of the supernatural opens. When we pray in tongues, God's miracle door opens. When we pray in tongues, God's healing door opens. When we pray in tongues, God's faith door opens. When we pray in tongues, God's word of knowledge or telepathy opens. When we pray in tongues, God's decision-making, divine decision-making or word of knowledge, that opens. When we pray in tongues, we can see our whole life is full and blessed. Now let me end by giving a very personal example from my life. You know, many years ago when I was in Calcutta, I was praying for a wife. And the Lord told me, why don't you go and, you know, fast and pray. So I started fasting and praying. But during my fasting and praying, all I could do was pray in tongues. So I tried to write down notes. I tried to read the Bible. But when I prayed in tongues, I felt happy. I felt really close to the Lord. So I kept on praying in tongues for 40 days. And during that 40 days, God told me that I'm going to get married to a woman. And her name is going to be Ruth. So I wrote it down in my journal. And then I forgot about it and I also lost that journal. But I had written R-U-T-H, Ruth. My wife, her name is going to be Ruth. And then many years ago, I went back to Calcutta. I was married. You know, I had two sons by that time. And I went to Calcutta and I was walking in the streets and I met one of my friends. His name is Sanjay. And I said, Sanjay, you know, I'm married now. I have children. And he said, yeah. And your wife's name is Ruth, right? And I got shocked because I had forgotten. I said, how do you know? He says, remember you prayed, fasted 40 days. Then you told me, as I was fasting, God gave me the name of my wife. Her name is going to be Ruth. So then I got very excited. I came back to Kathmandu and then I spoke to my wife, whose name is Ruth. And I said to her, I said, look, God spoke to me about you. Actually, I've forgotten about it. That when I was praying in tongues, God gave me the interpretation of tongues, which is your name, Ruth. And I said to her, you know, she said, okay. Tell me when you were praying in tongues. When did you have this fasting and prayer? So I told her the year and I told her the month. And now her face became bright. She looked at me and she said, no, that's the exact same month that I was leaving Darjeeling. I was going to Sikkim. I was on the train. And on the train that month, the Lord said, your name is Reshma Hingmang. From today onwards, you're no longer Reshma Hingmang. You're Ruth Reshma Hingmang. And see, the Holy Spirit spoke to you that you're going to get married to Ruth. And at that same month, as I was going to do a DTS in Youth with a Mission, in the train, God told me, from now onwards, your name is Ruth. So when I was praying in tongues, God gave me the interpretation that my wife's name is Ruth. And her name was not Ruth at that time. But God told me she's going to be Ruth. And that same month, even though we didn't meet, we only met. So that was 3 years before I met my wife. So 3 years before, she changed her name to Ruth. And that same month that she changed her name to Ruth, God had already spoken to me. While praying in tongues, he gave me her name. So what I want to encourage you is, when we pray in tongues, pray that we have to interpret. When we speak in tongues in a church meeting, pray that we may interpret what we said. Sometimes the interpretation will come through words. Sometimes the interpretation will come through an action. Sometimes the interpretation will come through some other person. And we will see that miracle happen in our lives. So tongues and interpretation of tongues is a twin gift. A gift that we are supposed to use together. Okay?